About a month ago, the first teaser for the new Marvel 1943 Rise of Hydra game came out, and it looks pretty interesting. It'll be cool to see a different setting and story than the type we normally have in a superhero space, and there seems to be some pretty good acting from the characters. I'm also really looking forward to seeing how good the Captain America combat is. But beyond all that, what got the most amount of hype was the graphics for the characters, more specifically, how realistic they look. And the hype is real, because they look about as close to real people as you can get. It's crazy. But I also saw some people telling others to temper their expectations, because great graphics doesn't necessarily mean the game is going to be good. Which is true. But they count towards something, right? A lot of times in gaming discourse, I'll see some claims that graphics shouldn't add towards the quality of a game if the rest isn't up to par. This got me thinking about graphics and the effects they have on the quality of a game, and whether they should be accounted for when reviewing a game. Do good graphics make a game better, and do worse graphics make a game worse? Or, in short, do good graphics really matter? Graphics have always been the touchstone for an advancement in technology and quality, you know. A new gen of consoles come out and most of the focus is on how good the graphics have gotten. As we've gotten closer and closer to modern day, the jumps have gotten noticeably smaller as we get closer to realism. The latest jump being almost unnoticeable, because some PS4 games already have incredibly realistic graphics. And that's what I and most people mean when we say good graphics. Realistic. There's been some criticism for the improvement in graphics, because some players say that the point of gaming is to not be like real life, and realism takes away from that. Although, this can be said towards any gaming feature, because what you want to get from games can differ vastly from person to person. A critique that holds a little more weight is that graphics can often be a nice shiny cover-up for a game that would otherwise be not as enjoyable. An instance of this can somewhat be seen in a couple games for me. Horizon Zero Dawn isn't the most enjoyable game. The mechanics and story are serviceable, but it's obvious that the crown jewel is the graphics. In Zero Dawn, but more recently Forbidden West, the world has so much beauty to it. Every corner is filled with amazing scenery and detail. The dinosaurs and nature all look so gorgeous. But how much does it matter if the rest of the game is alright? Cyberpunk. This is a game I enjoyed well enough, but it is clear that the main focus is on the world and how good it looks. You can tell how much work CD Projekt Red put into making Night City look as lived in as possible. There's so much detail. You'll walk down a hallway and you'll see trash littering the ground. In the elevators, there's flashy advertisements for fake products. The cars have intricate, glossy interiors. Walking down the street, you see towering, reflecting skyscrapers and greasy food stands. You take in all this incredible imagery, and all of it immerses you in a way no other feature can. Even though I may not love the combat and narrative, the graphics always give me something good to look at regardless. The graphics count even more when most of the game is spent just exploring a world, because what you're doing most of the time is just looking at it. Red Dead Redemption 2, it's got some of the best graphics out there, and one of the biggest open worlds out there. You can put hundreds of hours exploring everything it has to offer, and that means the visuals have to look stellar. There's so many places to go in the world, every one of them looking ultra-realistic to give you that sense that you are really in a late 1800s America. Much of the game is spent riding from one mission to another, and you come across some amazing scenery. It helps with the atmosphere of the game. When you ride over a waterfall, the rushing water, the glimmer of sunlight off the river, the sound of the hooves on the bridge, all of it comes together to create a moment otherwise glossed over without the graphics. Death Stranding is a game where you're delivering packages most of the time, literally just walking from one building to another, which sounds really boring, but it's made relaxing by the beautiful scenery. It feels so nice to walk through a field with the grass blowing in the wind, a stream rushing by, and huge mountain to the distance. As a premise, Death Stranding sounds incredibly dull, and with worse graphics it could have been, because when it comes to mechanics, there are certainly some oversights. But the game isn't exactly about having the most fun gameplay, it's about the vibes you get when trekking cross-country. But the biggest example of graphics being a core part of the experience is The Last of Us Part 2. Like Death Stranding, most of the gameplay is spent exploring the environment. But unlike Death Stranding, The Last of Us is more about the beauty of a smaller scale discovery. Most of the game is spent walking around the broken city of Seattle, collecting materials along the way. Again, this sounds boring, but when you add in the astonishingly real graphics, it makes it infinitely more enjoyable, because it gives you something pretty to look at while looking around, which together creates enjoyable gameplay. The moments when you're crawling under a bus, or searching through an abandoned shop, are elevated by the murkiness of the water, and the rays of sun shining through the cracks of the wall. It also helps to improve the combat. A major theme in the game is the acts of violence you commit, and it's able to showcase this a lot better when blood spews out of someone and you shoot them in the head, or crush them with a lead pipe. The point has gotten across a lot better with this implementation. On top of the world and combat design, the performances are made a lot better with the help of enhanced graphics. As companies release more movie-style games, the realism of imitating a facial structure is used more and more often. Emotional and intriguing stories in gaming have always been told, but it's a lot easier to connect with characters when they look like actual people, rather than just a text box. The advancement in graphics when it comes to performances greatly improves the overall connection to the story, and increases the enjoyment in the game as a whole. Realistic graphics are more important when it enhances the enjoyment of the title they're accompanied with. In these games where they're trying to be as realistic as possible, the addition of lifelike graphics makes you feel so much more immersed. When it comes to games like Red Dead, Death Stranding, and The Last of Us, they give us an opportunity to step into these worlds that give us experiences that real life can't replicate. Whether it's exploring a post-apocalyptic city or drinking at a local saloon. The purpose of these games is to make us believe we were actually there, so therefore the graphics are part of its identity. But even if they aren't, good graphics boost the overall experience. They give you something that's good to look at while going through the game, whatever it is you're doing. Through in the city. In the fire. In the racing. In the acting. Imagine if in Horizon, the graphics looked like this. Even if it didn't look terrible but just a little outdated, it's still not as good as realism. So this begs the question. Are older games automatically worse because of the graphics? You go back to look at Arkham Asylum and it looks alright, I wouldn't mind it. But then you look at night and ooh, look how good the city looks. Look at how the colors reflect through the night sky. Look at the old Call of Duty. Not bad, you know, I mean, I played Crunker for a while and that game looks worse than Roblox. But then you look at a newer Call of Duty. Wow, how it's gotten better. That realism just makes you want to play it more. I touched on this a bit in my Has Gaming Gotten Worse video, but even though the graphics in these older games are the best they could have been at the time, that doesn't mean they should be considered in gaming discourse as equal by default. It's clear that better graphics make a game better. For the most part. You see, as I said before, the importance of graphics heavily relies on how integral they are to the identity of a game. So games like Death Stranding and The Last of Us really bank on the graphics being good to make their games fun. But then you take a game like Sifu, where it's just about kicking ass, and the graphics don't need to be good. The whole time in Sifu, you're just going from one room to another beating up people, and that's where the enjoyment of the game comes from. Would it be nice if the graphics were top-notch? I guess, but it doesn't really matter. You wouldn't have to pay attention to them anyways. The same is also sort of true for older titles such as Ocarina of Time, where the worst graphics are part of the charm. The design is so polygonish while still keeping the colorfulness the game needs. But this idea comes back to the original question of, should a game's graphics be considered in its judgment? And to that I say, of course. You wouldn't omit any other feature from how much you enjoy a game just because it's easier for bigger, rich studios to get. Graphics are a big help in making a lot of games as incredible as they are, and they should be appreciated just as much as any aspect in the game. The realism they bring to titles is often more than any combat or world design system could on its own. But I've been talking a lot about realism for this entire video, and that's because it's what comes to most people's minds when someone says good graphics. But they're only part of the picture, because a whole other category of visual beauty is found in... When the gameplay trailers for Tears of the Kingdom were being released, even though Breath of the Wild already existed, there was a bit of discourse between morons about the graphics not looking good. This had always annoyed me because when it comes to graphics, it's always important to distinguish a game from aiming for realism and having an art style. Realistic graphics are great and a safe way to make a stunning game, but so much beauty can also be found in thousands of different art styles. Tears of the Kingdom doesn't look realistic at all. But that obviously doesn't absolve it from being able to look incredible. The art style for Tears is more of a Studio Ghibli look to it. It allows the scenic vistas to look more sweeping and calming than they would in real life. The landscapes are brighter, making Hyrule a cheerier place to explore than most realistic open worlds, while also keeping up with their scope. Some art styles like this replicate realism a lot, while also having the creative freedom to be able to shift aspects to enhance the things that make real life so pretty. In most cases, it involves increasing the saturation of the world to make the colors pop more, like in Elden Ring. Not only this, but FromSoft made the whole game look like a Renaissance art come to life. Every mountain and castle you come across has a resemblance to a painting with its mix of colors. It uses real-world realism to enhance the detail in not only the nature and kingdoms, but the Ur Tree and the moon you always see riding around the open world. And then it uses its art style to make these things pop out in contrast to the background. Games like Elden Ring and Tears of the Kingdom use realism as their stepping off point, but then modify it to make it their own identity. Just the Legend of Zelda franchise alone contains so many different art styles. In Wind Waker, they use a bright cartoony look to portray the childlike adventurous atmosphere of the game. In Link's Awakening Remastered, there's a plastic glossy design to the world, signifying the innocent but imaginary island of Kovalent. And in many 2D games like Minish Cap and A Link to the Past, they use pixel art. I love it when games have pixel art. It's such a delicate and beautiful way to design the game, especially when they use bright and bold colors like in Sea of Stars. In this game, there's countless gorgeous islands with so many different climates and nature. Look how pretty this tropical island looks. See how they got down the shimmer of the sunlight off the water? And the beautiful exotic fauna around the hot sand. They somehow transport you into this dreamlike Caribbean island by just using little cubes. But the most impressive use of them is when you're sailing through the sea of stars and it looks like you're floating on liquid space. Incredible! A similar kind of art style is a cartoonish look with bubbly colors that explode in your face. Games like Mario Odyssey and Penny's Big Breakaway have this, and it's largely because they're very fast-paced. You don't need to be stuck in a section for long to appreciate how they look. They give you something really flashy to notice while cruising through the games, and so everything's gotta be loud. Look at this section of Breakaway. Your attention is drawn to 50 different spots, all the while you're chaining together combos. In Odyssey, every kingdom has its own color palette that is mixed together to blow you away. And the ray tracing. How many times will I have to mention the shimmer of light off a waterfall before it gets annoying? Because I'm doing it again. Boom. The contrast of this big, catchy art style and the toned-down realism that comes with titles like Death Stranding and Red Dead Redemption is a testament on how they're meant to be played. In the games I just mentioned, they have to shove all the goodness they can down your throat because you're moving at such a breakneck pace. But in longer games where you spend walking from one place to another, it can be more restrained with how it shows its beauty, making it so that it's the player's job to notice it. There's also some art styles that meet you in the middle with their delicate hand-painted graphics, like Hollow Knight and Hades. With these designs, you can appreciate the charming backgrounds and moments when you're fighting for your life, while also seeing a soft-spoken elegance in those moments where you're just walking around. In Hades, when you enter a new area, you can look over the edge and see the gauntlet that lies ahead. There's so much scale portrayed in how it looks, almost as if it's a 3D painting. In the sewers of Hollow Nest, lights from above peek through cracks, shining your way through the dungeon. Rayman Legends also contains this style, most notably in the woodland levels, where there's an unreal amount of detail put into the hand-drawn background. Not too much to where it's daunting, but just enough that it enhances the overall enjoyment of these stages. There's so much beauty to be found in what seems to be just a simple design. There is an infinite amount of art styles to choose from. I only spoke about a few popular ones, but there are countless games of their own. Borderlands has this weird graphic novel look to it, with thick black outlines. Ori has this magical thing going on where every tree, plant, and creature looks enchanted. Cuphead looks like it came straight out of the early 1900s, I love it! Every frame is drawn with such love, and the film grain really sells the vibe. The graphics of a game establish the atmosphere and identity of a game, and it can't be understated how important they are. They can do everything from wow you to setting the scene for the experience. While there are definitely some games that don't need good graphics to be enjoyable, they certainly go a long way in improving the experience, whether they're bubbly and cartoonish or ultra-realistic. Graphics can be the thing that gets you through a long delivery run or a quick platforming section. They can be the thing you remember most about a title. And when Rise of Hydro comes out next year, whether it's mechanically good or not, I know that the impressive visuals will set the stage for 1943 in the best way possible.